Blimey. Hello, folks. Welcome to Reloved Guitars Workshop. And it's higgledy-piggledy in here at the moment today because I'm doing loads of different things, including getting this baby ready for its hardware installation, I suppose. It's pretty much got everything in place. This is the Oak Caster Mark II treble guitar, which will look something like this cute little thing when it's finished. With an interesting headstock arrangement, which is different from the previous one. I'm not sure how well it will work. Anyway, this is one that's been done by chisel, and the next one is going to be done by routing, so it's going to look nice with lots of blingy hardware on it, and a Wilkinson humbucker. So that was just a quick heads up. So all manner of little bits and pieces on the go, including this Telecaster body, which I'm sanding down. You might like my Hoover arrangement here, hung from the ceiling, as all good things are in this workshop, but really handy when I'm drilling something like that hole. It just lets me suck up the solder straight away. I've only just thought of that, but it's quite an expensive way to do it, since the bags are 2 quid a time, and it pretty well fills a bag up very quickly. Anyway, it's better than having it all over the floor. Down on the floor, I've got loads of templates. Let me show you. You might find interesting, or you might not. There's a O-ring from a grease gun, which should be on the grease gun, but it isn't. So there we have stuff. I'm going to probably do some more true oiling on here. I was thinking about insulating the cavity, but I might do some more oil first, or I might do the cavity and then do some oil, probably the other way around. My temporary amp, while the other one's indoors. Down here we've got some templates for cutting out another guitar. While I've got this oak, I'm just going to cut another one. They seem to be quite well liked and they play brilliantly, so if I can just keep them playing the same and sounding the same, or feel the same, they're a really nice little talking point, conversation thing. Anyway, but here's the bit. I was sort of getting the video ready to go. So this is addressed to you, Steve, Big Steve. This is put this back on here. This, Steve, is the Ibanez. Why did I say Ibanez? The Peavey, made in Korea, seven string monster. And this arrived in the post this morning. I have to say, if you ever think that couriers are bad and don't care about getting their stuff there in one piece, this came in a thin gig bag, a really insubstantial gig bag, and that was it, with a label attached to it. And to their credit, the post people have brought this in one piece to my door. I mean, a few things need tidying up, but by and large, it's all there. So this, Steve, is the start point for our experiment to make your ultra-wide six-string guitar. And just looking at it now, I chose this because it was second-hand. I didn't want to buy a new one. This is interesting. This is screwed into the body. This wide bridge, I haven't really had a chance to make a comparison with our new Schaller, but I'm going to have to fill holes and sink new ones. That's pretty pretty much certain. But the idea about this is, if I can wind these off to their extremes, you won't be able to see this here, but let's say, for example, I can just tell you straight away that at their widest, this bridge can set your high E and your low E, remember, think six, as far apart as these currently are. So it'll use the whole spread of the neck. That's my first concern. So yes, this six-string bridge with custom width settings will allow us to use the entire width of this guitar. Otherwise it would look a bit silly having widely spaced strings but loads of space either side. So outcome number one is these will be pretty much the same space, your high and low E, and then everything will be spaced equally in between. And obviously then this is going to require filling these holes, re-drilling, and same for the stop bar, but that's absolutely fine. It'll just leave a little bit to fill, and we can do that. We won't fill it with the same colour, but we'll fill it with something. Might be, we may find a similar colour, but anyway, it's not the priority right now. and this thing, apart from that, all seems in good nick. It's got a coil tap on it. Like we were saying before, Steve, this experiment is, we're going to give you a six string with a widely spaced, a wide six string over these seven pole pickups. Now, I know it's not ideal, but it's it'll probably work, and it's better than not having a nice wide six string guitar at all. So we can start with that, and if necessary, then what I might look for is a replacement, replacing these seven pole pickups with blades designed for seven string, but which will cover the whole space, and the blade is continuous rather than separate pole pieces. So we should be, we do have that option, and there are some very nice Seymour Duncan style ones, but that's quite a big price step up. So let's get this thing kind of constructed as a six string first. Let's get that bit working with this fabulous bridge and you know, another stop piece. What will happen is when we use the conventional six stop piece, we will get a slight fanning of the strings, but to be honest, it isn't a problem at all. That's not going to have any impact on the strings at all. It's just going to be a mild angle as it spreads out to meet the new wider spacing, but it's not going to affect it. I haven't got the nut yet anyway, so I have no idea how that's going to work on here. This one's been, looks like it's been custom cut, or somebody's made some adjustments and ground it down quite quite aggressively. But what they have done in the past is they've created themselves a low first fret action. I mean, it's immaterial for us because we're going to ditch all of that, but it's somebody who's had a go at setting it up, and it is, you know, for a tapping guitar probably, it's actually quite well set up as it came. It's very filthy, so I'm going to take care of all of that. So we will strip it down to right down to its parts first, and normally if it was just a six string guitar that I was setting up, I would start straight away with the action part and the fret leveling, because I don't, you know, I'd live with the dirt for now and get the basic fret leveling done with the guitar fully strung. We might as well do that, so then we can throw away those strings and do all the cleaning and tweaky stuff afterwards. This one's different because we've got to do quite a lot of structural work on the body. I'm going to take the neck off, clean it separately, and we'll make an adjustment. Ow. We'll cut part of this off, or we'll either cut or fill. I think it's probably better just to cut, and being this is you know, clear lacquer and black, so we can make that look tidy. And then we will we'll do the reshaping of the nut, and then I'll take care of these bits here, and I'll need to get some hardwood. I've got hardwood, but I need to get some hardwood dowel that will fit this. And we'll fill that and then re-drill holes to take the new bridge and so on. But it's looking good. I'm very excited about it, Steve. So I hope you've got patience. The only little insult that came with this guitar was that on the back. I don't know if it was aimed at me or Parcel Force, but despite that, it survived. So when next time we feel like bitching and moaning against the Parcel Force or various couriers, they're not all dedicated to smashing your equipment up. Just, I think it's much rarer than we kind of imagine. Of course, nobody wants to take the risk, but I'm very impressed. I don't think they make it very easy to give them feedback, but I would give them positive feedback in this instance, because I think what they've done, you know, for me, they've always brought, no matter how badly wrapped things have been, they've always got them here successfully, so I'm very pleased with that. Okay, so I'm going to cut off this video for now, because I'm going to go into doing a bit of fine chiseling on the jack plug socket part of this, and then I'm going to do some more true oiling. I was so tempted to just kind of rush on through and start filling this thing up and putting all its hardware on. We're so close to doing it, and you know, the neck's ready to go, and here's the lovely shiny gold bridge, and you know, dying to do it. But I think I'm just gonna give it that bit of extra work with the true oil. And partly that patience is driven by the fact that I'm aiming to sell this one, so you know, I've got to get it, I've got to make it good, it's got to be the right thing. Okay, another little thing I did here, when you make a guitar and you need to put a bridge ground in, I find it in the past I've really struggled how to affix a wire to a bridge. If you put it on the outside, it clogs up the hole and stops the thing going in. So realistically, the only option it's got is, if you're lucky, it comes through into your electrics cavity. But how the hell do you get it to stick? You try it with a soldering iron, you'll never get that to stick, ever. So what I did was I kind of put this in a clamp or a little pincer thing, and I loaded inside here with some solder, and then I burned or heated up from the outside. And as soon as that melted, then I set it up again with the wire balanced in it. This gets really hot, so it takes forever to cool down and set. So you have to have all this kind of held in place and set, so you can just leave it for the few minutes it takes to cool down and hold it. But having done that, now I've got a wire that's really nicely attached. It doesn't clog up any of the screw thread in there, but it's really well soldered in place. Sorry, you can't see that anyway. But it just makes this part of the guitar simple. So we've got a nice earth, and when I put all the electrical shielding in here, it's a bit of a luxury, but it looks nice. It adds to the kind of luxury feel of it. Because this won't be cheap. This takes quite a long time to make, and it's very, very bespoke and custom. And the other thing about this guitar is I haven't really got a Morris logo on it, and it'd be a real shame to put this guitar out into the world without a Morris on it. So I may be tempted to take all of these off and just sand down a bit, put a Morris on there, and then re-lacquer a layer or two over there to give it a sort of bespoke character. But it's also, I'm really interested to know, it's got a little brass adjustable, micro-adjustable nut. You'll never see that under the magnification. But it's designed with a sort of adjustable crosshair, and it means that you can turn it in or out, move the string, put it back on, check the clearance, and keep winding these little nuts out. It takes some modification work on your on the nut slot, so you've got to be confident enough to cut that out, because of course if you kind of move away from the correct intonation point, you'll mess up the intonation. So I probably would have done it a little bit tidier now if I'd done it recently, but this was done about a year ago. But I'm really keen to see how it works, and it adds a nice sort of dimension. I may well buy it again if it actually plays well. Anyway, that's a distraction. Steve, if you're watching this, looking at your extra wide six string Peavey, that's a little hijack your guitar video. Anyway, so I'm going to cut a little bit of extra step on this so that I can sink this slightly further in. I don't want it protruding outside. I don't want it flush with the back. And then when I've done that, I'll continue with some that stuff, oily stuff, and then I'll come back and I will get on to dismantling the Peavey. So I'll see you like in a flash. So by the miracle of cut and paste, stop and start, here we are back with the Peavey 7-string. I've never played one of these before, and what do you do with the extra string? Well, I think the first thing I'm going to do is just make sure it actually works, because I don't really know. Oh, don't really know anything about it. So, I mean, apart from the fact it's like a big slab, let's see what works and what doesn't. Let's just plug it through the workshop amp. Yeah. Coil tap, I think, possibly. Tone works. Volume works. So three position switch. Never know, it may have the... No, just three position. Okay, so everything works. Don't know how you play it. Supposed to be. Anyway, there you go. That's a good bit. It works. So, good start. So, without further ado, let's just get this thing apart. Let's get screwdrivers. Let's get... Where are they? It's all a bit of chaos over here, doing several different things all at once, but we'll get there. clippers, choppers, slicers, whatever those things are that cut wires. Yeah, so first time seeing a 7-string, and instead of sort of enjoying it for what it is, and I mean, this is like a bass guitar string. Instead of enjoying it for what it is, I'm going to mutilate it and do something else with it, which is just, you know, a one-off. I wouldn't normally mutilate guitars just for the fun of it, but you know, this is it's an interesting concept. Can we make a playable 6-string guitar out of a 7-string, or is it a complete waste of time? Having said that, I have had an email exchange with a somebody in China. Just, you know, it's one of those Chinese manufacturing guitar manufacturers who say they can do anything you want. And in fact, I wrote to them asking them about, they advertised a 7-string kit, and I think I asked them if they did a wide 6-string kit or something like that, and then they said, well, we can do anything you like. So we got into that conversation, and next thing that was happening, they were saying, well, what's the spec you want? And before I know it, I was sort of speccing out something. They've come back to me, and I haven't yet gone back to them, which I need to do. And I suppose it's one of those things that you could probably, these days, get somebody in China to manufacture a small number of guitars to pretty much your spec. Although, having said that, I did think that what I wanted, which was an ultra-wide 6-string, probably involves so many non-standard things that it might be too much of a hassle. Whereas when you think about you know, changing things on the chassis of a normal 6-string, then it's not such a problem. But realistically, if you're making an ultra-wide guitar, you really don't want to be using the 7-string or 7-pole pickups. You want to be using 6-string pickups, but then you want ultra wide pickups for this, for your new spacing. So that's a whole, to me it seemed like that would be a whole manufacturing retool, if you like, or quite a bespoke custom thing. So I'm not sure whether that would turn out to be of any commercially feasible for these companies. But hey, you know, mine's not to know that. It's all down to them. So it was interesting to just carry on having that discussion, and we'll see what comes out of it. So I'm going to just cut all these strings and bin them, even though I've never seen a piano string as big as this before. Blimey. Actually, I think it's a quite heavy gauge anyway, generally, because they all look a bit bigger. So there's my 7 deadly strings. They are deadly because they always end up stabbing you one way or another. It's just par for the course. So there's the 7 strings. Hopefully it's going to end up being the last time we play as a 7 string. So yeah, who knows, the Japanese manufacturers might, for all I know, might come up with a reasonable, you know, sensible price and be able to manufacture exactly what we're talking about here. But in the meantime, I'm just looking at what it takes to convert something, whether it's feasible or not. Now, you probably saw a bit that I remember from a bit earlier on. If I just poke this down there, we have the shallow bridge. The good thing about the shallow bridge was shallower German bridge, was that it sits in there and it has quite a wide spread, and it takes up most of the width of the neck, so we can use all of that neck for this ultra wide 6-string. Just looking at the frets here, they are a little bit worn, so there is going to be, we need to do some fret leveling and reconditioning anyway, but that's a bit later down the road. So this shallow bridge, actually, it's got very fine, what do you want to call it, gizmos. In fact, are they designed? Yeah, they are. Ouch! Oh, that's my Kindle Fire firing off telling me I've sold something, but it works, seems like it works an unspecified number of hours later than every other device I've got, so I think that's probably something I sold yesterday, cashing in on the Kindle. Anyway, yeah, so these are designed to go into the existing bushes, which is a bit of a pain, because that means realistically I'm probably going to have to dig those out, which is going to make it a little bit harder. But I've got a slot here that I can fill in, I can route out, I can do anything I want with it. So we're not going to worry about that just a second, we're still in taking things apart mode. But there we have the bridge that we're hoping will provide us our interesting wide six string. And in a way that's the kind of new bit on this. I think a number of people, or some people I've seen making conversions, have tended to do things with the 7-string bridge and try and kind of use all of those saddles to end up having 6 new slots. And it involves, I don't know what you call it, hacksawing little grooves and whatever into there. And from what I've seen, it ends up looking quite ugly, because it's clearly not a part. It's not doing what it was meant to do. So having found this shallow bridge, it's quite interesting because it's a part that will do the thing we need, which is to have 6 genuinely good saddles spread to the width we want. And there aren't many bridges like that, so it's quite a rarity. I will remove this cock and ball signature. Sorry if that's offended anybody's youngsters. Steve, I'll take that off. I'm not sure you'd appreciate receiving it. It'll take a bit of fiddling, and I don't want any of that jamming under my fingernails just for now, so I'll just hold off that for a minute. What I'm going to do is take the neck off so we can just get things work with slightly smaller things. I'm going to start with the torque on this screwdriver of about 5 and see if that's enough to take it off. No, 6. Usually about 5 or 6. Sorry about the noise. I need to find a container for all these parts as well. Well, made in Korea, this, so. Usually, I mean, it's not much of a muchness now. The quality of Chinese guitars is so good that, I don't think there's any kudos or big deal about something coming from China versus Korea. Now, this, just FYI, this neck has a couple of shims, a little bit of tape, and a tiny bit of cardboard. And we're going to want to make sure they stay there. So what I'd like to do, just to be on the safe side, is take a photograph of that. There's no point making a problem for ourselves if we don't have to. So if we can just get a picture of where what material it is and where it sits, and if it falls out while we're doing something, then we can always just put it back in. Okay, so let's have a look. Let's take the tuners off as well, because I want everything off if I'm going to restructure this or reshape this thingy, whatever it's called, headstock. And the interesting bit here is that we don't need these 6, 7, we don't need all 7 of these machine heads, of course, so we're going to lose one. And some people lose one and then plug the hole, so they keep the overall shape of the headstock. But you know, if we're modifying this all together, we've got the opportunity to, or the option to, change the shape of the headstock. So it could end across there like that. There's no reason why not. And if we wanted to, we could clean this off and re-lacquer it or repaint it, and give it a completely new identity. You know, it started out as a Peavey Predator, but now it's something else. So just as a thought, we've got basically our set now works, although it's a strat-shaped kind of guitar, we're working as three aside. And it'll be sort of fairly obvious where they fit when we come to put them back on, so we don't need to mark them or anything, they only fit one way. But I am keeping these, the original ferrules back with, or keeping them with the original. They're nice, nice quality little tuners, those actually, surprisingly good. Well, not surprising, I like Peavey. Peavey's, the two or three I've seen have tended to be very, very good condition, including one belonging to Bob, my old mate from college, and it was a Peavey Patriot, I think, and fantastic old early 80s guitar. And I hope I see that one again for a refret. I think at the time I did the setup, it was the amount of fret material left was marginal, but I didn't know or didn't have the wherewithal to refret, so I managed to do a sort of fret level and recondition the guitar generally, but it was lower in terms of fret material than I would have liked it to be these days, so I'm hoping to see that old beastie again for a cut price refret. So Bob, if you're listening, whenever you like, you can do it. Okay, so there's all my tuners, four on one and three on the other side. I'd like to get the Made in Korea sticker off and the CE. I honestly don't know why anyone would want to leave those sort of things on there. Got to get a cloth and give it a bit of a clean down as we go, just really to get some of the grime, general grime, and also remove the glue from things like these stickers. This naphtha stuff that I'm using now is not as good as the previous stuff. I mean, it does the same job, but it actually evaporates too quickly, or much quicker. The other stuff had a much lower evaporation rate or something or other. But it does a job, which is to remove solvents and sticky stuff. Sorry, it is a solvent. It removes glue and stuff very easily. Stickers and whatnot. Okay, so just now cleaning up some of this. It's a nice headstock. I don't know. Maybe I'll put a question out, Steve, onto Facebook and ask you what you think about the reshaping. It seems could be an overkill, really. I mean, in terms of if we were thinking about keeping this to the best possible price for doing this work, then it would be an unnecessary modification. It wouldn't change anything about the guitar. You just have an extra hole at the end, which you know could be a feature. But you know, if we take it off, we get a different shape headstock. Okay. Now this one. Let's just look what the neck's doing. Slightly. Sitting slightly on the, well, it's got a, hard to say, on the treble edge it's got a tiny bit of relief, on this edge it's straight, except it's got a plateau here, so where it thickens up, but it's not too bad. Generally, all told, it's not a bad neck at all. It'd be difficult to choose how to, if I were going to level this while the neck was off, I'd be struggling to know. Let's fall over my templates while I'm in here. I'd be sort of struggling a bit to know where to set this, because it's slightly convex on this side, including this plateau here, and then just slightly concave as it should be on this side. Altogether, it's not twisted in any way, and sometimes you get that when you see one side slightly convex, you kind of expect the whole thing to be twisted, but it doesn't work like that for some reason. You get a kind of slight relief there, and a slight convexity there, and yet the nut is parallel or in line with it, so it's a weird one. But I think I will leave the levelling right till the end when we're setting up the new six string, because I want to take away as little material off these frets as possible, because they're They're not brand new, which again for a guitar like this we wouldn't in any way expect them to be. So I've just got to be careful. Well, the watchword is on, I suppose, taking as little material away as possible. You know, because they're not brand new and they're not starting out with tons of fret material. Now we're going to lose this nut altogether, so I'm just going to give it a little tap. And I don't know if that's supposedly a graphite one or a plastic one, but it's conveniently split anyway to begin with. And out it comes. And I'll clean up that slot and we'll get ready for the replacement, which I haven't got actually. But that's going to be a single piece that I'm going to measure and cut the new slots on here myself. Sorry, microphones. There is a little bit of evidence here that I remember I said that looked like a replacement. Well, it is, because you can see where somebody's hacksawed into an original nut in order to get it out to put the one we've just taken out. And sometimes you go a little bit too far and you hacksaw a line down there. It's no problem, but they've obviously had to hacksaw the nut to squeeze it and break it to get it out. But I will be able to just clean this up. Usually this file is just about the right size. It isn't in this case, so I'll do it with something else altogether. But yeah, there's just a few little things. And you know, do we want a filled up hole there and the same headstock? I mean, in a kind of way, we could plug that with a piece of hardwood and lacquer just that bit over and polish it up, and it would probably look quite like it belonged. There's no reason why. I think I'll err on the side of doing that rather than reshape the headstock. There's no real need to do it. It's not gonna make it look fantastically different. And the PV lettering and everything is quite nice. So yeah, let's keep it down to the minimum structural stuff. Okay, what else have we got to do? Well, we've got this here, which has got the shim in it, and the shim is just to tilt up the angle of the neck slightly. I want to take all this electrics out, but I'll take it out in one piece, and for now I'm not going to do any mess around with any anything. I'm just going to disconnect it basically. So being a Strat style guitar without a tremolo cavity at the back, I'm expecting to find that there'll be a cable anchoring it, a wire grounding it to one of the bridge posts here, and so it all should lift out except for one wire and the wires to the jack socket. And this just lets me really get rid of all of this stuff while I'm doing any structural stuff to reseat the new bridge and six string stop piece. God, there's so many words you have to remember when you're talking about guitar bits, especially if you get my age, then you start to forget them. Okay, so then we have our scratchy plate, and yeah, so we've got the one going out, or the paired wire going out to the jack plug, and then we've got the earth wire going here. For the time being, and no idea where these humbuckers are made. Being Korean, I suppose it might even be G and B's or something like that, which seem to be increasingly a Korean, or are a Korean humbucker, look similar to this, and they seem to fit, have been fitted to all different kinds of guitars, like nice quality ones like PRS's. Can just unscrew this. Sorry if it's not in view at the moment. Nice long screw holding that jack plate in. Blimey. Nobody was going to have that hanging off. with using a bit of a powered screwdriver at this point. And if you're ever using a powered screwdriver on the guitar body stuff, just by default have a discipline to set it to a really low torque. And that way, if you can't do any harm, no matter what you're doing, even if you make a mistake and go firing off in the wrong direction, i.e. tightening up instead of loosening it off, which you ideally are trying to do. I'm just going to warm up my soldering iron to unloose these connections. It's all a bit tangled up there, so I've got to be a bit careful. We'll just unsolder that, and then as far as the bridge connection goes, we'd need to put another one in if we move these posts. But So the thing we probably present most difficulty is just finding a colour that goes, or finding a matching colour that doesn't look crap if we're going to replace this, because we're going to get left with some holes and either fill them with dowel or hardwood or something. And it's never going to be particularly easy to fill that. Strangely, I've gone and lost, I don't know how I managed this, I've lost both sponges on my soldering iron. I have to go and cut some new ones. Where did they go? It's not passable. They'll be down the back somewhere, unreachable. Oh, here's one. I'll get some water on it. So sorry, this is a little bit long-winded, this bit. I don't like having these. It's quite an expensive soldering iron, but it's got a solid plasticky cable instead of a nice rubberized one. Probably should alter that. Okay, what I'll do is I'm going to cut the ground wire to the bridge post, because I can either replace it or redo it. Let's see if we've got enough heat to get this off first. It takes a while to warm up. Okay, there's one. Okay, unplug, allow to cool, pull through. So there we have it, our Peavey 7-string pickup configuration. Sort of standard, does the standard thing really. You've got an earth, I don't know, what have you got? You've got a coil tap switch, coil tap cable coming out from here, goes to the little switch down there, and the pairs go to normal spots on the board for your positions. So it's kind of ordinary stuff. The fact this one comes off, probably it needs a bit of tape on the inside of there or something, just to prise that split open a little bit to give it a bit more purchase. I'll give that a dusting over in a minute. But now here we are, left with our body and our offensive graffiti. But the important bit now will be, sorry, looking at my gob. The important bit now will be for me to let's get another. Have we got another bridge matches? I haven't got I haven't got another six string stop piece kicking around at the moment. But we're going to need to relocate both sets of, take these out and fill them. And getting them out might be quite difficult. I might need to lever them out. I might have some chance of levering them out with this. Oh, that's not too bad. Thankfully. Okay. kind of expected a bigger fight, I'm pleased to say. It was cooperating. You can do it. So, we're kind of on the go then, because we just need to fill. It's coming. Just need to fill those and then basically prepare and mark out the next positions. And we've got to be very accurate and careful with that, but that shouldn't be too big a problem. The difficulty here is I don't think I've got any stuff. What's that word? Dowel that happens to be that size. But I'm pretty sure I don't. Stuck at a... No, it's way too small. Okay, I'm going to have to go and get some. I don't want to spend too long making my own dowels. Possibly, I've done it before. Friends of mine where I used to work saw me take a block of oak once and sand it by hand into a circular filler, like a handmade dowel. But that took quite a bit of mindless work, but it's quite enjoyable. It's very zen. But they thought I was nuts when I could have just gone out to a hardware shop and bought some dowel to fit. But they don't know the pleasure of sanding down a piece of oak and turning it into a dowel, do they? Those unbelievers. Huh? Did I say that? Not a very good term to use these days. Right, so I'm just taking some... What's that stuff, you know? Naphtha, or otherwise known as, in this case, it's petroleum ether. It's the nearest chemical substance that equates to naphtha. I found it very hard to find agreement on what naphtha is. It seems to be a sort of at any one time, it's both a generic sort of description as well as a very specific description, and they can't quite tell what people mean. Used to be able to buy it on eBay, and then it suddenly became unavailable, and I had to settle for petroleum ether as an alternative, but by all accounts that was the nearest replacement. So once I get this paper off, the petroleum ether or naphtha will cut through this remaining glue very easily. Okay, and then what I'll do after that is I'll just pause and I'll just plan where I'm going to get this hardwood dowel from, or whether in fact it might even be easier to just to make some, given I've got the oak sitting here, plenty of spare hardwood. It's just whether or not I can create these filler parts easy enough. I think it probably represents a lot of hard work. No immediate need. Okay. So this has got quite a bit of sort of goo on it from its previous life. I don't know. Sometimes when you get a guitar, I'm not saying this one has, but sometimes if you get a guitar from a place where some people smoke, you can get a lot of sticky kind of nicotine, tarry residue. It takes a while to come off. This is probably going to need to be done with plastic, which I will find something to do it with off camera, because I don't want to end up sticking a little shard of this under my fingernails, because it will hurt like hell. Okay, so there we have it, Big Steve. We are so far into the process, all looking good so far. That looks like it's not going to present too many problems to drill, fill, paint, re-drill, put the new bridge and the six piece stop bar in place, and then we have the joy then of spreading the strings across the neck. Once we put the six strings on, then I can set up the neck and do fret leveling on the neck to clear up some of the dents and slight kind of dimples or whatever people call them that are on the frets after a lot of hard life. And then we can start to structurally put it back together again. It shouldn't be too hard. And interesting then to test, and I really don't know the answer, as to whether this seven pole humbuckers will work adequately with our new setup. The guy on eBay who I've watched before making these conversions, you know, and to be fair, you know, he's got clearly got a market there, as I think we talked about on eBay, on Facebook. He's obviously got a market because there are a lot of guys with big hands, and there aren't really many mainstream manufacturers making guitars to suit. This particular chap, he not only kind of butchers the bridges a bit, which is okay, you know, I mean, it's a way of doing it if you hadn't found an alternative bridge or couldn't afford to add that cost to the project. But so he kind of customizes the bridges, shall we say, but he also he clearly leaves the seven pole pickups in place. He doesn't do any other, he doesn't put any other kinds of pickups in. So presumably, with people buying those guitars, it must mean that they play to a fashion, and I suspect it will, but I don't think it would. Ultimately, it will be a bit of a trade-off with sound quality versus, you know, the fact that we've got this wide guitar. So yeah, it would be a bit of a compromise there, unless we do put on the additional, go and search for the seven string little blades. But as I say, that's going to add some additional, quite a lot of expense to it. But it all depends, doesn't it? You know, if it's something that's going to be your guitar for a long time, then it's probably worth getting some quality pickups anyway. And if that solves the problem, we can, even if it's something like Seymour Duncan's, if the guitar plays well as a conversion, then it's worth investing in getting some great sounding pickups too, if it's going to be a much played and loved guitar. I'm just thinking where to hang this set of electrics. In fact, I don't like doing it on that. That's too close. There's too much pressure on that piece of plastic. I hang up empty ones, but I don't like to hang up full ones. I'm gonna put them somewhere else in a bit. But for now, I'll just put them over on this other workbench and then get rid of that. Okay, so time to pause on this while I go and find a box for all the parts, which are sitting down there. Big, massive pile of stuff that goes with it. And find a box, and then I'm going to start looking for some dowel, possibly get some tomorrow, and then plan out, really, more than anything, plan out what I'm going to do to make sure that when I get this back together as a six string, it's perfect as it can be. And make sure, you know, if I can get that perfect, then it's worth investing in some decent pickups, which will solve the 6-7 pole issue. Okay, so that's all for now. See you tomorrow when we're back on the case and I've scraped off this offensive graffiti. See you in a bit. Well, I didn't have to wait long, actually. The dowel that I was using to hold up my towel dowel, which is now going to have to go somewhere else for the time being, but that was exactly the right diameter. So what we have is four little pieces cut, ready to go in to the thing. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to get a screwdriver, I'm going to get a different kind of screwdriver just to just do. Come on, somebody make it easy for me. That one. Just gonna poke. God, I can hear an airplane. What on earth is that somebody doing flying on a night like tonight? Can you hear it? It's not a good night for flying at all. Okay, so I'm ladling it on quite thick because it's got to form a nice solid thing. And I'm going to fill all four of these simultaneously, and then we let those dry over a couple of days, and then we'll be in a position to mark up new holes and drill. And these will be rock solid by the time it's set. They're a pretty tight fit anyway. But the glue is going to probably squirt out the top, but it just gives us an extra bit of binding. They claim that this wood glue is stronger than the wood it's sitting on. I don't doubt it. But there we go. Right. So let us commit ourselves straight away, as we just carry straight on. Here we go. This is sitting a bit lower than the surface, which is fine by me. Don't mind that. Cut them just a tiny bit shorter. And I'm going to... On this side it's a tiny bit shorter, on that side it's exact. But it's fine. Precise. There we are. Fab. Hey. Didn't think I would get that done so quick. I thought I'd have to go into town. And I have got some dowel stored away for other such times. So there we have it. Filled up, locked in place. I'm going to hang this up now and let it dry, and then it's a matter of measuring out exactly our new locations for our new bridge, and it will just be measuring in from the centre points of these existing thingies, which we can pretty much tell. It's quite easy to mark up the centre points of these, do it by eye, and then we'll just work our way in measurement wise from the centre of those. So not at all difficult. All good, going good so far. What I don't have is a 6-piece stop, or 6-hole stop piece. I have one on this guitar here, but it's been used. So I'll probably leave all this dangling for a few days now while I order one in from thingy. Get out of jail free Amazon. So here we go. Nice hang up and just wait around for the stop piece to come in. As I say, all I can really do in the meantime is when that has set, I'll mark up and drill the new holes for the new components. They're pretty standard size, so I could use, pick a measurement from the internet, or I could just use a stop piece from another guitar. There you go, everything hung up, ready to go, and sticky. Right, so what do I do now? I'll stop and I'll come back and you'll see the next bit shortly. Yo, so back with the 7-string, what used to be a Peavey Predator. I filled the extra hole, so I can polish this, or I'll sand this down a little bit and just polish it out so it's kind of level as level can be without doing a proper respray. But the fun part today that I've been really looking forward to is to cut a custom nut for this thing. So I've been, to begin with, just slack all this off in a minute. I've been using a acoustic guitar saddle with some masking tape added to it to thicken it up. But what we've now got is a blank, I don't know how well you can see that, a blank that is more than we need, which is great. So I'm going to reshape this thing in terms of both its width and its thickness to fit that slot. And then we're going to be able to cut the slots in it and start resetting this thing back up, including putting the electrics back in and get the action right. So looking forward to doing that. And to that end, I've got this block of sandpaper ready, which I'll be doing the reshaping on. I've also got quite a bit of work to do, potentially to start building a couple of oak plugs to fill the oak caster gaps, which I might need to reposition the bridge on it. But so it could be a dusty day today. Anyway, so I'm going to go away and draw up the measurements of this precisely so I know exactly what I'm aiming for. And I've got my micro thingy, my caliper, whatever it's called, vernier, I don't know what it's called, can't remember. So that's going to be my friend today, along with my bone nut blank. I've got two of those and some more coming for future use. But it's a fairly simple job. Okay, so we'll come back to that in a minute. I've just got myself set up. We know the exact measurement we're looking for in millimeters is going to be, let's just do it to the edge there. We've got a width of 48. That's really what's going on here. It's probably a little bit more. 48. It's actually just on 48. So I'm going to take a picture of this. So I'm going to rub that out. Interesting, I had, for those of you who watch this, including those of you who probably don't want to be watching this, you might have seen on my YouTube channel, had another professional expert luthier come on and tell me that I'm committing the greatest possible crimes and I should kill myself and stop doing anything I'm doing. And it's amazing how often this happens. And I've got, it's quite bizarre that somebody has a view on how something should be done, you know, and you know, has a notion in their head or in their, they've learned a right way to do something. Hello, sorry about this. And then they sort of appear and tell you that you're doing it wrong, and of course they know, because they know the right way. And the weird thing is, you know, I've got loads of feedback from people saying how what I'm doing for their guitars works. And the bizarre thing is that somebody who comes on, sorry, I'm just writing things here, somebody who comes on and tells you that they've been a professional luthier for 100 years and they know everything and they've worked on £1 million projects or whatever, and you're doing it all wrong. It's as if that sort of knowledge is supposed to, or that perspective is supposed to cancel out a couple of hundred happy customers that you've got, who all of whom leave very credible and genuine feedback saying, I made their guitars play better than they were playing. And it's just tiresome, really. And I really don't quite understand. Maybe I do, because probably I was arrogant as well in my own time. Actually, that's the truth of it. Years ago, I would have been that arrogant myself, and thought I knew the best way to do something. And I probably, if there had been YouTube in my day, I probably would have gone on it and told people how crap what they were doing was. You're playing with a rubber ring. So it just seems such a shame, really, that we seem to get that, and a lot of it on YouTube. And it used to really, really bother me. And nowadays, I have much more direct experience that kind of works against it. So, you know, somebody will write something like that, and I'll only just have shut my door to somebody who's come and picked up a guitar and they've sat there and played it and said to me how much they enjoy it and how great it feels to them and how much better it is than the thing they were playing before and so on. And it's the two things just don't sit together. It's a bit mad, really. You know, what there's one person's view which just doesn't tie in with another person's experience, and I just don't quite. Well, maybe I do get it. Like I said, I think I've, in my time, I've been as defensive or as arrogant about that as anyone else has been. So I probably do, if I'm honest, I do understand what it's like. And if I'm honest, the truth is, you can. It's all too easy to get into that thing where you comment, because what you're really doing is trying to make yourself feel better about whatever it is you do or believe or think or whatever. And you'll never admit it to yourself, but that's what it's about. Because somehow telling someone else how wrong they are is your way of momentarily feeling better. And like I said, it used to really, really upset me. And it's taken me about a year. Having a good time over there. I know you're going a bit mad because it's windy. I know. I think it's taken me about a year. I mean, that's the thing about putting yourself in the firing line or lifting your head over the parapet. You do open yourself up for criticism from anyone and everyone who's passing by. You're inviting criticism, I suppose. It either does one or two things. It either makes you give up because the knocks are just too unpleasant, or the alternative is it kind of forces you to assess what you're doing, and in that you have to look at what works and let it in and accept it, that, well, I'm not making it up. There are loads of people who come, sat in my house, played their guitars and said things like, oh my God, this is so much better than when I brought it, that kind of thing. And that's reality. That happens. That's experiential reality. It's what happens. And what isn't reality is somebody's view online about what should and shouldn't happen. Isn't that right? Ooh, lovely wet nose. So it's just difficult. I had to make, I have to make decisions about, do I just dump those things if somebody's like that? Do I just kill off their comments and call it quits? And on my channel, why not? Oh, you're so sweet. 3.86, Morris. Is that on the mark yet? I mean, it's very, 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 very small amounts. 3.81 will do as a starter. Okay, my boy. I'm just gonna mark this. I'm gonna go just only oversized, because I'm gonna take it down to there, and then I'm gonna slow down and I'll edge it in as we get closer. So this is not now scientific, because you see I'm not using a square edge. Sticky nose. I'm doing this by eye. So don't move. Don't breathe, Morris. There's my reference points anyway. Yeah, that's what I'm aiming for, folks. And then I'll work out the exact slot positions after that. Let's get down to the basic unit first. You're going to help me do this? I doubt it. You've got sticky stuff in you. Yeah, I'll get down. I'll just work my way down to the right level. This probably isn't the right grade. I might as well do some rough stuff to begin with. Sorry, Morris is definitely in the way. And I always find it easier just to tack it down. Yeah, so anyway, the point being is, if you're watching any of this and, you think something is wrong and it kind of provokes a reaction in you, such that you want to come on board and write a comment and tell me how crap it is and how fantastic you are because you know better, just take it from me, it's about you, not about me. Okay, the reaction you have is about you, and I'm not really interested. What I'm interested in is the continual ongoing comments from happy customers and people who send me messages on YouTube saying things like, I watched your video, I went and did those same things to my guitar and now it plays brilliantly. It's like, sorry, but you can't cancel that out. that just is what it is, and I'm going to take my lead from that. Okay, and if you have a bad reaction, please take it somewhere else, or you know, if you're really enlightened, go and have a look at it. That's what I would say. Deep down inside, it's about you, but hey, most people on YouTube probably aren't enlightened and likely to go and self-evaluate, but of course you would, instead of posting negative comments. Anyway, there we go. So I'm just going to get stuck into this. It's going to take time, and I'll come back to you when I'm anywhere near the dimensions that I'm looking for. And just slowly and surely. I don't want to grind it down with a mechanical thing. I'm just going to wear it away nice and slowly by hand, so that nothing goes off in any direction in the wrong sort of way. And you know, visually you can see what's going on. I can see where I'm flattening it off and not getting the right finish on it. Just keep looking and feeling, that's all. Good stuff. It's very, very hard to sand something flat. You could set up a jig if you wanted to do it. But if, again, the way I see it is, if you take it carefully and you prepare to stop and slow down and readjust, you can do it by hand. You're just looking for something that's going to fit comfortably into that slot that's cut in the wood. It shouldn't take too long on this kind of rough paper, actually. Get there, not too far off. Get close, then you can switch to the finer papers and take it slower. If you wanted to, keeping the bone dust is quite a good thing to do, because you can put it in a pot and keep it for those days where you might need to fill a nut slot or fill a gap between nut and neck, that kind of thing. It's very handy to have some freshly ground bones in store. It's very, very rapid. It's not 100% flat, I have to say, right at this moment in time, but I've just been concentrating on taking volume to begin with. I'm going to start paying a bit more attention to the levelness of this. Nice. It's looking good. I could either shave off the end or I could cut it off. I've not really tried cutting bone with a saw of any kind, so I guess a nut file would do it if I really wanted to. End up with a flatter surface than I'm currently getting. I need to adjust my technique, because going backwards and forwards is not working. It's taking down the nut in terms of sheer volume, which is good. This morning I treated myself to a Henry Hoover for the workshop, which is a real extravagance, £100 Hoover, but for this kind of job, so I can hang its tube on a rope and have it pointing at here, and I can just basically suck up the dust straight away. That would be cool. And so same while I'm drilling things or working with anything that's going to create sawdust. And then I'll be able to run that and the power drill together on at the same time. Okay, we're almost on the line on that side, but we're not exactly flat, so time to aim for a bit of overall levelness now, I think. Look at all that lovely bone dust. If I hadn't have knocked the pot on the floor, I would be capturing that right now. Maybe I've got another container I can put it in. Probably the right thing to do. Alright, scraping all these. Yeah. Put it in a little tiny pot. So let's put it on a piece of paper first. Do you like the smell of that? You probably knows it's cattle. I used to be a drug baron in a previous life. Sorry about this. Bang! There you go. As my stuff, man. Beauty. Look at that. A whole little supply. Bone dust for another day. That with a bit of super glue will make a fabulous filler for messed up nuts. So now I'm kind of focused on getting a flat level on this. And we're getting there, and I'm gonna now shift. Not a very good idea. I'm gonna shift from this rough stuff to this underlying fine stuff. And I'm gonna look at where we are. I'm just gonna take it round in nice little circles now. Concentrating on the overall level. And what I'll do is every now and then, as I get to this level, I'm going to just see if it goes anywhere near fitting the slot, which it doesn't because I've marked over and above deliberately. I want to give myself a bit of playing room. Good fun, this. Having a piece of sandpaper taped to a solid flat block like this, and this is white oak, which is very, very solid, is a really useful thing to have. It provides you with a working surface that you can constantly come back to. Getting there. Still a little bit of a unstraight. You can change the way it sands by just pressing the weight down on a slightly different place to bring it to an overall level. If you can see it's not cutting accurately, you can level it up. Getting closer. Morris is trying to go out the door, but it's not cooperating. Do you want to go out? Here we go. Go on. Go on. You going out? Go on, Morris. Go on. The wind's making it difficult. Okay, so that's interesting. Look, there's the heart of the bone. It's got a different colour to the bleached outside. Not a problem. I'm going to sort of try and stick to going in circles here because I want to let this even itself out now to a really nice level flat surface. Bing. Difficult to handle sometimes, a small thing like this. You could build a little block to seat it in, that would make it easy. And actually, you could probably, if you're doing a lot of this, I'd probably make a little cavity in a piece of hardwood and then just kind of keep going until you flatten back to the surface of the hardwood, so it would be a sort of jig of sorts, really. But as it is, I'm just going to continue to do it by hand. Point being is, if you go a little bit smaller, in the end it will still fit nicely into the slot. Not many nuts fit exactly into the slot that they're cut for. There's usually a bit of play. Particularly if it's a replacement one. Yeah, getting there. The end bit will be easier do and easier to see. We could put it in a vise and file the end off it if we wanted to. That's nice and flat now. So we're getting there, and we're down to the line, which was an oversized, overcut line anyway. So I won't expect it to drop into that slot just yet. We're going to do a bit more. I'm going to do a bad thing and dump some of that dust on the floor of the shed. Better underfoot than being breathed in up here. So just like a lot of things, nice and slow, stop, gauge it up, see what it's doing, if it's even coming close to fitting in, and do a little bit more. Ow, get your fingers caught underneath it, skids over them. A bit of a storm going on outside. It's not exactly cold, it's blowy down here, west of England. I'm just starting to feel it wants to go into the slot now, so we're just sizing it really now, on thickness wise. Long strokes like this on the sandpaper are a good way to ensure the overall flatness is retained. The shorter strokes is where you get lots of, you know, rocking contours, but long strokes will eventually cut a flat edge on it. And again, trying it in the slot. The only thing that happens is you just get sore fingers after a while. I'll put gloves on for this bit. But there's something about being able to feel what you're doing with these little bits that always feels right, even if it is a bit painful and tiring to hold it down so much. Nice. And are we there yet? No, we're still not there. Where do I want? I want to put this up here so I can get a quicker check. Yeah. I don't want to cut the slot anymore. I want to make the nut fit the slot, really. You know, once you cut the wood down, you're stuck with that slot. I'm sure I could do it, nice bit of chisel work, but why not cut a £1.50 or whatever it is, bone nut, which you can always start again with another one if you get it wrong. It doesn't really cost you much other than time and patience. So we're almost there now, starting to grip the nut. So we're almost at size. As soon as it fits in, I'll stop going in this direction. You can see a lot of materials come off it, so we've taken loads off. Okay, we're starting to get into sitting in the slot now on both ends. Yeah, just about, yeah, it's quite tight. That's nice. I'll do a little fraction more on the thickness. In the slot. Obviously we're not going to need all of this height either, and I'm not going to adjust that yet. We can actually put it in and then physically cut that with a file once it's in the slot if we want. The profile of the nut only has to only has to follow the radius, and I can use a radius gauge to reshape the radius on here once we've got the nut sized. So here's the end bit, which we can just kind of take down in the same way. This is a bit that I've been caught out on before, is when you're taking this bit down, it can go very quickly. Before you know it, you can be overcut and find yourself with it, having done all this hard work, and then you've got something that's sort of undershoots the end of the neck, which is a shame, and you end up having to build it up with, you know, nut dust or something. So don't go beyond the line on this one. Better to have the nut in place and once it's glued in, finish smooth off the end with a file than to cut it short beforehand and be trying to build it back up. This is a lot easier to hold in some ways, because you're putting a lot of force down into a single surface. But it equally doesn't cut quite as straight, because you've got a smaller guide surface to work with, so you can very quickly put a slant on this if you're not careful. But this is alright. Oh, cutting into the paper. And again, blimey, bone is sharp, that's the other thing. Once it starts cutting the fine sort of edge to it, this will be very, very sharp edge. And once we put it on and cut it down to the profile we want, or the contour we want, then we want to soften it off with sandpaper anyway, so that nobody's going to get caught out by that sharp edge. I don't have string spreaders a la Stumac style, so I tend to use other things which are far less glamorous, like, for example, a bit of tape will do the trick, just to hold these strings out of the way. I'm going to throw these strings at some point anyway. These are only ever going to function as the sort of tester strings. This process. Can I pull down and hold on somewhere under there? Thank you. You know, sometimes when you're doing something like this, you can sacrifice a set of strings for the luxury of being able to do. You know, just as long as it's out of the way of the slot for now. Yeah, you can prepare to sacrifice some strings just for pleasure of getting it all right. It's a little bit thicker on one side than the other, but that's okay. I'll use the thinner side for putting it in place, and then we'll contour off most of the thicker part of it. all over my fingers anyway, and getting them hooked up in a bit of sharp bone can add to my misery. Right, try and get a few straight kind of slices on it before we put it into place. Okay, so thin edge in. Now, the simple thing is, if you want to get a draw profile on it, you can either use a radius gauge to do it, or taking something like this, I think you probably can see it, we'll make sure that it's how cleanly it's sat into its slot, and it's not cleanly enough for my liking yet. I have to say, actually, the slot isn't exactly pristine. I'm going to need to file a bit of that goo out before I commit to this this thing. So I'm just doing a bit more off the width of this thing to make sure it sits as far down into the slot as it should. And that will be helped by getting some cleaning up going on in there. Yeah, not quite what I want yet. Sits in one end a bit better than the other. May well have to do with the crud that's in here. So I'm going to get a small file into here and do a bit of clean up. Oop, crash. I have something really made, which is made from a piece of fret wire. I can find it. Come on. Took a piece of fret wire. It's very thin. Cut off all the tang underneath, gave myself a flat surface that curved over the top, and then stuck a bit of sandpaper to it. So what it does is it gives us a little file that will go into this slot quite nicely and help to clean out some of the crap that's in there. We want to blow it out as soon as we get done. And also I can put pressure on it and it will sort of bend into the bend into that slot quite nicely. Technically it could even run along the sides here as well. Make sure that's not got any residual glue stuck to it. There is some glue I can see on the bottom of the slot. So let's see where we get with this. Yeah, it's still a tiny bit on the wide side. If I just want to help it along, what I can do is get my chisel and just use it in here as a sort of a way of perhaps dislodging. I'm just dragging it across by hand just to dislodge any large bits of glue that are sort of sticking up from the bottom. It's not exactly cutting anything, but it may help. I'm going to be careful around here because some bit here is quite delicate. It's very easy, and I've done it loads of times, to end up with a bit chipping off there. Did it with my own old Stratocaster, and just had to glue it back on and write it off to experience. It just sort of tells you to be careful or gentle around this area, because that's not a very strong piece of structure. I can hear some old super glue crunching against this sandpaper, which is kind of good because it means it's clearing it out. That's a dead handy little tool, that thing. I'm really pleased to have made it. Now we're getting almost down into the bottom of this slot. And again, I can help it along by just taking a little bit more width off this piece. But it's a good thing to do, to make sure both sets of surfaces are as clean and junk-free as possible, to get the best possible fit you can have. it doesn't, it's not going to change the way this sounds, as long as the nut is sitting firmly in its slot, making a positive connection with the wood, it's going to work. There we go, we're almost sat perfectly. It has a bit of a curve to it, so there's a, I don't know if there's still a lump in here. Some nut slots can be curved. This one isn't meant to be curved, but it has a bit of a tilt over, so it's telling me that there's a high spot in here relative to the rest. So it's not perfectly flat, but we can sort of wear it away as much as we can to get it even. So it, you know, as long as it sits in, it's going to transmit, or it's going to provide a stable platform for the strings to allow them to resonate, or whatever the word is, sustain, resonate. You can use these words, and somebody is going to appear and tell you you've used the wrong words. You know what I mean? It's going to let the strings do their thing. Okay, nice downward force, nice connection. It'll do that. The fact that it's got a little tilt is just about the lack of relative straightness of this, or flatness of this trench here. And with this little file, I'm doing as much as I can, given the access I've got to it, to level it out. I don't have a little nut file, which if I had, I could just quickly do it. A saw, or yeah, there's a file you can get that fits this. I don't have one of those, so I'm making do as you can do in your own shed with your own tools. Necessity and invention and all of that good stuff. So I'm comfortable that will fit nicely in here. I could do a little bit more sanding just to make sure there's, get rid of that last little bit of rocking. Putting a little bit of downward pressure on this at both ends just so it's reasonably effective. It was more like this end that's got the build-up of glue. Okay, let's do the thinnest wedge end first. Okay, let's have a feel. That looks pretty good. I'd be happy to glue that baby in place. So what I'm going to do is, just before we do any gluing, I'm going to draw the profile or the shape of this neck onto this piece, so I know. I'm going to tell myself, I'm going to draw a little arrow on here saying, actually I'll do it with permanent pen. We're going to go bottom down here, and we're going to go front facing here, and we're going to take it all off with a file anyway at some point, so we don't need to worry. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to draw the shape of the radius onto this nut, and I can either do it with pencil, which is less mucky, or I could do it with marker pen if I didn't mind the chance of getting a bit of that onto the bone. So there we have a drawing of the profile of this guitar while sat against the nut as it sits in, or against the nut as it sits in place. Now I can see that the nut tilts down a bit, so I might just ignore this for a minute and go again on, spend a bit more time, I'll do it off camera now, but a bit more time on the on cleaning this nut out, the slot, sorry, because it's still rocking too much to my liking around something that's clogging it up. I don't want this downward movement, so I'm gonna mess around with this with a few more things, and I'll come back to you when I'm ready to draw the radius of this guitar onto the nut. So back in a sec. Right, we have a nut that's beginning to take shape. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to rub this face down and remove the pen marks, because I don't need them right now. We'll do the rest kind of by eye. The thing about drawing the neck radius onto the nut isn't it's not critical in order to seat the strings. if you've watched any of the videos I do, you'll know that I'll seat the strings by height over the first fret individually, and that will be my guide. And because they'll each be, let's say, 0.3 of a millimeter above the first fret, they will naturally follow the radius of the first fret. Simple as that. I don't have to draw it on here and micrometer it and get it, you know, cut exactly. I'll cut according to the first fret. And that's how I'll know that it's the right thingy. Now I know this is obviously way too high, and what's going to happen is I'm going to get some cuts that go a long way into here, because I don't need this much material still on top. I could keep on slicing away for a long time with files that I just have in the vise, which is quite slow, but bizarrely satisfying as well. Or I can go for putting it into place, and then aim to get it, put it in place, cut the nut slots, and then reshape around the nut slots, which is a way I'd prefer to do it, including this sort of run up from the back of the nut. So for example, you know, you see the nut slopes this way. I don't need to make that slope. I'll make that slope with, I'll do it here because it looks nice, but the really important bit is you do that slope with the slots. It's the strings that need to have the slope, not the nut itself. And you, as I say, you make that slope appear by cutting the slots at the slope. It doesn't matter a damn if you've got a nice looking slope coming off the up the side of the nut. It doesn't matter a damn if your slots are straight. The slope on the nut doesn't count for anything. So it's about making sure that you cut the slots in the slope. This could be square on. As you've probably seen on many guitars, it is square. Okay, so I'm going to put that the way I want to put it. I'm going to get some slightly higher thickness glue, and I'm going to get my air can. If I can remember where I put it last night. I'm going to just blow out the slot here. Just get rid of as much glue as possible. Also blow the bottom of the nut, and I'm going to place this in with some thick gooey super glue, which takes a while to come through, into the slot, and it will sort of work its way a bit up the front as well as, there you go. And if you get any on the front, just wipe it off quickly onto some surface you don't care about. Okay, so in goes the nut, and it's, I'm going to make it wider at one end only, and I'm going to line it up perfectly if I can. Let's get a bit of extra space. I make the alignment perfect at this end here. Start with it out a bit and then push it in. Have a quick look at it from the side. Yeah, that's nice. And I'm going to just quickly, well, not quickly enough because I've tied these down, but I'm going to use my strings, these strings I don't mind sacrificing. I'm going to use these babies and that one as a counterweight to force the nut down. So it doesn't matter where they're pressing at the moment, just the fact that they are pressing down. And I'll do the same here. We'll just use that instead of clamping it. It'll do the same thing. Now these aren't going to be the exact positions of the strings in the final reckoning. There will have to be a little bit of a curving inwards. But this is just going to begin with, just hold it in place. That's string, it looks like it's going to break shortly, which I don't mind. This is going to cost a set of strings along the way. Okay, so there we have, I'll leave that for now. There we have the nut blank in place, and obviously it's going to take some more shaping because it's too high. But once it's set in place, and then I'm going to measure the and mark the slots, And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut down to get the playing action I want at the first fret. Notwithstanding that this first fret has to be lowered a bit because it's got some dents and surface imperfections which we're going to have to take out in fret levelling. This guitar is quite well played, so you know it's going to be marginal on cleaning up all of these dents. So, but when I set the height of the first fret, I'm conscious that it's going to lose some height, so I can afford to be quite precise. So if I go for a 0.3, set the slots in here at a 0.3 above the first fret, then for example, I know that by the time I've done fret levelling, it's going to be 0.35 or possibly even 0.4, something like that. It won't be that much, it won't take down a tenth of a millimetre, but it will increase the gap, so we can be kind of, we can go to the low extreme. The reason I put this one flush is because I want, it's easier to finish just one end rather than finish both, because you do tend to just scuff the finish a little bit. So I'd rather just be taking it off one end and just touch up one end with a bit of repairing lacquer, if you like, it at the end of it. And come on, off you come. All right, so I'm just going to basically pop this to one side and let it set in place. And we'll come back to that later when it's good and solid, because it needs to be good and set, because we're going to take the file to it later on. Let this dust go out into the world. Come back into the ground and become reconstituted as some other creature. Right, okay, so Big Steve, I hope that was interesting. A bit long-winded, but it always is, you know that. Hey. Clean up the lens. There you go. Sorry about the noise. Right, so I'm ready to do some other thing altogether. And I can't think what that is right now, other than I think I'm going to take apart the old oak caster, which I don't really need to film, so I can treat myself to a bit of radio listening. So that I'll come back later on when we're getting ready to set up the first kind of action on the doofer over there. I'm going to... Yeah, before I get into fret levelling on that, I'm going to slack the strings off, lift off the back end, clamp them off to one side, put the electrics in, rewire them up, stick them back on, then set the nut slots, then do the fret levelling, and then test it out and see what the 7-pole pickups sound like on a 6-string conversion. Oh, radio, go away. Phone, go away. Sorry. Lots of bleeping and stuff. Right, so here's a cool thing. Having pulled a piece of rosewood from an old guitar, and I'm now getting ready to get this thing the right way round, and I'm cutting a very careful and precise trench out of this here guitar, so I'm going to make sure that we get a lovely perfect fit of rosewood into here, very similar, and then I'm going to cut out again the correct way around, so, and I'll measure and make sure it's exactly the right dimension to the jump off point of the strings. So that's off to the side for a bit more finesse later on. Meantime, back in the world of things, we have the conversion here, which now will be beautifully thingied, you know what I mean, glued in place. What I wanted to do is I'm going to take these strings off and take the bridge off and hang it off to one side, because what I would like to do next is to put in the electrics to get them working, so that when we get back to when we get back to putting the bridge and the stop bar and the strings back on, what will happen is we'll be able to test it out. Even though the strings aren't going to be the ones I want to keep on here, there'll just be some test strings. We can certainly get to hear whether or not this 7-pole pickup business works. So in discussing this with Big Steve himself, who this is kind of aimed at, I found some I have found some pickups which are blades or single piece pickups, designed for 7 strings, so we know they've got the right width. Let me get this over here out of the way. This is just oak caster stuff. So I found a pickup for 7 strings, which is a blade construction. So unless I'm completely mistaken about the internal structure of a blade and how it works, I could be, because I don't know. I'm hoping that will give us it will give us a pickup that will work with 6 ultra wide strings, is what I'm trying to say. Anyway, okay, so here we have the 7 string. As I said, I'm going to now put the electrics back in, which means I'm going to move these components out of the way before they take a trip down the back of the workbench, which I can do without. So I'm jumping between loads of different things today, and it's really stormy outside, so I've not been kind of stopping and doing my normal cleanup process. So off comes the tape, and this is really all we have to connect up here is the... Sorry, that's not all we have to connect up. We have to reconnect the jack through there, and we have to reconnect the earth here, which is a bridge, an earth to the bridge post. Then what I'll do is I'll start getting absolutely accurate with the positioning of these adjustable doofers, and then after that it'll be a matter of getting the thing strung up, and then we're going to, while the strings and everything are off, I'm going to measure and mark up the nut so we get those string positions. And I'll do a bit of quick calculation again with a calculator. I've had enough of getting things completely wrong, but I'll make sure that the nut is divided. I had it down as 8.4 millimeters, and I'll double check that measurement at the end. I'm conscious I've got a bit of a hangover here, which I can take some of away with this file. And this under here doesn't quite fit this, of course. It's built for different size guitars, so I'm just taking off the excess overhang on this side. Now I'm doing it where I can see it, so I can spot where it's beginning to make contact with the binding, not the binding, the lacquer running alongside the fingerboard. Just doing it very carefully, rounding a bit off at the top here. Okay, a little bit more to do. We can get a more precise, smaller file to do that bit. I just really wanted to get it pretty close, because I want to not be distracted when it comes to measuring the overall width of the thing. So if we can start with it physically being the same width as the fingerboard, that would be great. Now, I always, to get this exactly flush, you are going to touch the lacquer on the edge, and there's two things I know about that. One is that with some micromesh paper and a little bit of careful, delicate wet and drying, you'll get the finished polish nicely back up to what it was before. And if that doesn't work, propellant, if that doesn't work, then you can add a little bit of lacquer and shine that up itself. While I'm there, I'm going to also just take off the sharp front edge of this. That's one of the things that can quite often be left in place, is the quite sharp nut, and it can really mess up how it feels to play. So I'm just rounding off the corners, which probably won't get touched, although I will sand down the top. I'm not going to do any more to this corner. So the smoother it is, to begin with, the better we'll be. Okay, well, this is fun. Right, so I've got the soldering iron on with a view to getting the getting the electrics back on and working. So I need my solder, my pliers, probably a little hand grabbing thing, and then also dig out from my parts bin the remaining important bits, or the important bits for now, which are the jack plug, and that's it. Oh, and the pickups from over here, which I shall bring in. So I'm looking forward to doing this. I'm pleased that the nut blanks arrived, so that I could get really stuck into this. God, it's weird that this thing doesn't fit a 7-string guitar. It's not made for that. Okay, so again, this is not going to look like much because this camera doesn't have the focal length. So this is a bridge earth, and I need this to go to the top of the volume pot. Sorry, not the volume. This one's a tone pot. It can be either, actually, volume or tone. I need some. It's a continuous one, so I can join it. It's probably easier to join it, actually, rather than just use one or the other. They're both connected at the moment. If I join it, I just got a bit extra. Oh, do you know what's happened? I've broken my heater thing, and I can't shrink wrap. Blast, I'm going to have to buy another one. So my nice idea of shrink wrapping these things together goes out the window, so it probably then just makes sense that I still will join it, and I will join it and use a bit of old-fashioned electrical tape. I'm ashamed as I am to say that. So let's just reclaim my knife. If you watch this channel for a long time, you'll see that these knives have been the death of me. My own fault. There's loads of knives, blades and things with proper handles that I could use, but I never do. I like living dangerously. So first off, I'm going to what am I going to do? I'm just going to try and realign myself and figure out where's my easiest way in. So I've got to go through to the jack. It's got to poke out all the way out through the side. So if I can lean that against there, push this through, get it out the back. Come on. That's typical, it's sticking into the side on its way through, resisting any movement. Come on, you want to come through. Thank you. So that shouldn't be too difficult to move that around. Then I'm going to join. Well, I'll do the join on here first, then I can shut it and do the jack plate secondly. So I'm going to coil these together to begin with, just to give it something to hold on to when I make this joint. And I can just pretty much go straight there with the soldering iron. Going to clean off. Get my solder through. I still lament the cable that comes with this iron. It's a great little iron, but the cable is really stiff and plasticky, and I would so much prefer if I could get myself one with a rubberized cable. I mean, maybe you probably could just do that, but it's always in the way. Okay, so that's the earth taken care of, and I can just sort of wind. No, I was going to cover it with a bit of tape, wasn't I? Not my ideal solution, but better than nothing at all. Just to make sure it doesn't rub against anything and make a short. Okay, so where all that sits. Flop it in, okay, for the time being. I'll double check, you won't be able to see, but I'm just making sure there's nothing sitting obviously in the way, which it currently just about is. Get this round the corner. And would you know, it's the one I've just added. What you just want is for the whole thing to just sit nice and comfortably. Now I've gone and, oh no, I've still got that sticking out. I've got enough to work with. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to get a thingy, pick guard screw or two, and I'm just going to tack a couple in here. I might need, I have to bear in mind, I might need to pull them out again to do some alterations or something, but for the time being, it'll work just to keep the thing anchored down while I'm doing the nut work and so on. Of course, if everything works, we can then just lock it all down. Right, now I hear that wind kicking up. Lovely. So we're sort of back to where we were. A new nut in the end, waiting to be cut. And I've got sort of sneak in here and get the get this thing done, jack plug. And I'm going to use for that, I'm going to use the little claw handle robot thing, which never holds it very accurately. So we've got, we have got, it's just useless actually, drops it on the floor. So we've got the earth and the hot and the hot. The earth is, let's do the hot first, or the live or whatever, and that one goes to there, so it shouldn't be too hard to do. I haven't got my zoom in specs on, which does help. Sorry if you can't see any of this in close up O-vision. Angle everything before I even start. Have a bit of solder ready in case I need it. And I'm going to go into this one from the outside. I'm going to hold that on there and let it set good and proper. I think that's good. Using the old solder. And I'll just cut the excess sticking out off. Just goes flying. And then the fun part is getting round to this one. Now this has been cut, I think, so it's going to be shorter than it was before. So first job, I think, will be to take out the riff, the detritus from the previous thing. So I need a pair of pliers. They'd come in at a usable angle, and there we go, out comes the crap from before. Twist this a little bit, if it will stay down. Give myself a tiny bit of slack, and I want to now, this one, I just would love it just to fall through the hole. Damn it. I'm doing anything but. Damn. It's bending backwards, upwards, downwards. Anything but go through the hole. Let's just make sure this isn't too spiky. So these clamps ultimately sometimes are almost next to useless. And you've got to hope that with a little bit of movement you'll get this through here, but it won't need too much pushing. For some reason, this just does not want to go through the hole. No, I don't know why. So what I'm just going to do is I'm going to suck out the excess solder on here, whatever's going on falls on the floor because it's useless as a gripper. I'm going to suck out the solder because it's gone too low down for my liking, and I don't like where it's gone. Come on, liquefy. No, it wasn't liquid. Trouble is, we've got no pressure at all with this weedy little pair of hands. They won't hold it in place. Okay, that gave us a chance to get rid of some of it. Nice big lump of wet solder coming off there. So I can see the hole now, and it just makes it easier for me to try and get this manky thing through. If necessary, if there's a clagged up bit right on the end, just snip it off and work with an even shorter piece. Again, we have to try and rely on this slightly worse than useless pair of hands, robot hands. Bend down, fit in, attach. So just get this thing seated through the hole for a minute, off to one side like that. Now we have a chance of attaching it. Hopefully we don't have to move too much around to get this to work. Sometimes it's good to have the old head-mounted torch on here. Okay, that looks good. Let it cool for a minute. I love the little tubes you get, the tubes of solder out of the solder sucker. It's a handy little thing where I come from. Okay, so we've got the jack socket done, and that's with the wires all sort of pointing away from each other, which is always a nicer way to do it. I can just drop that thing in, and it usually has one way or another that it likes to go. So I'm going to fit it in the correct way round, which is this way. Blimey, almost this way. Is that right? Yeah, it'll go. Just, sorry, you're not getting a view of what's going on much, but I've got a screwdriver on very low torque just to get these into wood and get them down. You don't really need to put any more pressure on, they're just holding a cover in place. There we are, jack plug in place. And now for fun, I'll just do switch the soldering iron off. I'll just do a quick test to make sure before we go any further that the pickups are working as they should. I forgot to give it a bit of a shot of contact cleaner under there. I should really have done that, but single, I think so. Okay, three position switch all working as should. So progress, we're on the way. That's good. So next stage will be, let's get the nut marked up. And once we've got the nut marked up, we can then start the process of making the first marks. So we'll just do a calculation again just to make absolutely sure. And I'll use my caliper thing for that. My numbers wiped off here. We've got the nut done. So now we just need to double check the width we're playing with, and it should be zero this, it should be we'll just go by the neck first of all. Okay, we've got 47.92, so 48 mils, and then we want some space, so my guide was to have, we can either do it with 40 divided by, where's my phone? 40 divided by 5 gaps. 40 divided by 5 gaps is 8 millimetres, and or we had the other one which was 8.4, and I guess that was 42. Let me just double check that. An 8.4, that's what we started out saying we were going to do. So 8.4 is the answer. What's the question? 42 divided by 5 is 8.4. Okay, so we're going to go with 42 as our playing width. So I'm just going to wind this up to 42. Give or take a fraction of a millimetre. It's very, it's accurate, but it's not the world's most accurate thing. So putting this, laying this on the nut, I'm just visually seeing where the strings would fall at this point, how much room there would be. And I'm just going to make a mark with my pencil, very sharp propelling pencil, a mark. This is just slightly inside of the caliper, so it's about, actually, it'll mechanically come in as 41.5, but just start with that, and we're saying that would be our start mark. Now all I'm really interested in at the moment is does this look and feel like enough room for a string to play? Now it's going to play onto a new piece of fret, which is quite interesting. So the places where it was worn before aren't going to be worn quite the same. In fact, I can see that it's probably going to be just, actually it's not far off. The first strings are probably exactly where they were on the 7th string. All we're going to do is divide up the space differently. Okay, so we had our start point. Now I'm pretty confident that that's just off the mark. So I'm going to do it slightly differently again, and we're going to get the pencil, use the pencil again, which is nice, I can rub that off. So this time I'm going to go with 42. Come on, 42. 41.99, that's close enough. I'm going to go with 42, but this time I'm going to place this against the nut, and I'm going, or just over the nut actually, and I'm going to mark the as close as I can the actual point of the caliper, and that is going to be my start point, end point. And what I'll do, I think I'll just do this in pen. So these are my boundaries, what we're dealing with. Okay, those will obviously be the first grooves, and then we're going to go 8.4 for each of the strings. And again, I'm going to do this bit in pencil. 8.38, it's very close, and I'm going to try my best to go to the caliper's points. Not caliper, is it? I don't know what you call it. Gauge, vernier gauge. There's one, and then we go from the middle of that one to the next one, and then we go from the middle of that one to the next one, from the middle of that one, which doesn't, amazingly, doesn't quite work out. Which is glad I've done it in pencil. So it's tricky. That may not be the most accurate way of doing it. Let's have a look at what our marking is. Centre of our pen, 41.93, that's pretty good. And then we go back to our 7.7. 8.40, that's correct, the first one. Second one's correct. Third one's about right. Fourth one's a tad short. Okay, so the maths on this are not working out for some reason. I don't know why. I don't know why that is. 8.4. I mean, there is some thickness to this line. Tell you what, let's go with 8.3 to account for the thickness of the pencil line. I mean, it sounds a bit silly, but that's probably what's going on here. 8.39, 8.22, 8.2, 8.29, 39, 38, 36, 37, 26, 32. Very, very difficult to actually hold this and do things with it. So I'm going to try and go to the centre of the pencil mark, allowing for a little bit of inaccuracy. Okay. It's amazing that still getting to that last one, it feels. No, actually, that's on, that's spot on. Good. Right, so we have the marks, ladies and gentlemen. On your marks, get set and go. So just fractionally under the 8.4, and I guess what we're talking about is tiny little parts of a fractions of a millimetre. So the scary bit, let's mark these in mark these with 70 piece of metal, really, that's all I want. I don't want something too substantial. A piece of plastic will do. Hey, right, look at that. There are our cut marks. And one of the things that, since I'm going to lose quite a bit of the height off that, one of the things I'll do is I'm going to start this with, rather than start with a nut file which is inherently bendy, I can start with a stiffer file, like a diamond file, if I want to. I'm allowed to. And I can use that to ensure that my first marks, or the first cut, is on the line. Now, it's going to be a little bit thicker than I'm going to want in the end, but at least it starts, starts the mark. And then I can, when I cut down the nut, I can remove wider, slightly wider mark, and I'll go forward with the nut files from here. I'm just making the start point. It's quite difficult to get it exactly on the mark. It's not as easy as you'd think it would be. And before I go too far, I'm just going to double check that it's where I want it. And if not, I'll just scrape off that bit and start again. About this sort of slow pace, but you know, oops, that's not staying in one place. We want to get this right. And finally, this one's a little bit more difficult because it's just on the curve of the thing that I've already rounded off a bit, probably a bit more than I should have done, so just I have to be careful. This gets a little bit of a downward bite before I turn it upright. Okay, that's very good. We've got our 8.4. Now, of course, I have to say, if we go ahead and do all this, restring it, whatever, you know, get it all set up, whether 8.4 or a gap of 8.4 is too much and it feels uncomfortable or not. We don't exactly know. What we do know is that the Big Lou guitar made by someone else has an 8mm gap, which is obviously not the same. Now, I've got my electrics working. I've got my nut in place. Now what I can do is reinstall, get out of here flies, I'll reinstall the strings and do just a bit of straightening out, fiddling about, but I'm going to put them on here because as I cut the nut slots, I want the strings available to me so I can only cut them as far as the correct height that we want is concerned. So right now they're just going to sit in the beginning grooves and we'll get a look at how it feels. If it's just not right, of course, what I can do is I can start again with the other blank, and I've got loads more of these blanks in case I need them, but you know, if it just doesn't seem right, then we will recommence if we have to. But who knows? Very fine grooves at the moment. So anyway, this is it's been really an interesting little project to do, and you know, as we were discussing, Steve and I on Facebook, and I guess a few people have said it before in the past, that there really isn't that much of a provision for people whose hands really are very, very large, and for whom sort of regular guitar playing can be difficult. There's a tiny difference in spacing now. So this is what's really good about this. You can line these things up now and see what looks right as a slot actually can be just slightly out when it comes to the strings being on here. And if that's the case, before we go any further, I'm gonna realign that E string and make sure we get it, in this case the E, I think, bring it back in, which is good as far as I'm concerned, because it gives us a little bit more room, a little bit more empty fretboard at this end. This side is what I like. This is all, I hate doing this side of the head when it comes to restringing, because it's back to front. There's no real way around it, in my experience. Also got to do the all the business down this end with the with these saddles, which I think I've already done, but I'll recheck them manually. Now these thinner strings start to get really difficult to work with. In fact, I got enough wind onto. I'm just going to pull these through a bit further this time and go kind of straight into. Don't want to wind on too much because it's just a big fat hassle. Now that's interesting. One of these is a different tuner, and I probably could replace it. And if it's been replaced at some point in the past, but I think I'd like to replace it with the one that's come off. Except it's from the wrong side. Damn, so I can't. It works, it's just got a couple of different washers in there and spaces. I think what's happened is somebody's worn out the bush on the tuner and they've made their own. But that's fine, this is we're prototyping really, more than anything. It works, that's the important thing. If it had been the other side, I could have swapped it. Come on through the hole, yes. Thank you. Okay, so what I'm sensing is that the gap might be just a fraction too big. No, actually, you know what, it isn't so bad. Now it's back on the rails down here. That one's got a little bit of winding to go, which I haven't taken into consideration, so let's put that as wide as it goes. And that one's as wide as it goes. So that all right, that's correct, that adjusts the gap out. Now jumping off these very rudimentary slots. But just as a quick glance now, this is our playing action. Sounds like a frog. Okay, so we've got a huge gap. Obviously, it's way too much. And we've now got a massive spread of strings. The question is, you know, they are actually, they're not bad. They're not too close to the edge. They don't automatically fall off, which is great. So I'm going to get handy with my filler gauge, thingy gauge. What was it? Now the question I had is, if I was just doing this the way I'd normally do it, what I've noticed is I'm as far down, I think, on the bridge as I can go, and the action, if I get my device out here, is it's 2.2 millimeters, which is higher than I like it. So what this tells me is I'd much prefer to shim this neck slightly. I can do it in this situation. I can take the neck off. I will put a cap on the string so they don't just flail everywhere. Crunch. And I'll just slack them off a little bit. But I want some movement on this. I don't want to be slammed down on the stops here and still have an action that's higher than I prefer it. So I'd rather put a shim in here. And the shim I'm going to do is I'm going to cut a copper shim, custom shim for the job. And the shim is, I never see anything when I've got my close-up specs on. The shim is just under a millimetre. So if I put one piece of copper under here at this end, that's going to raise that end up by a millimetre, which means we're going to go from 2 millimetres height to 1, which is a bit less than I'd like. So then it gives me a bit of play at the other end. So just I'm going to mark, I would if I knew where my marker pen was, I'm going to mark the length of shim that I want. It doesn't have to be absolutely accurate, and in fact I've got it right here. It's this little sticky out piece that will do just perfectly. And I'm just going to slice it off with my snips. Try and cut it as straight as possible, but it's hidden from view, so there it goes on the floor. So it doesn't have to be the world's most aesthetically pleasing thing. What it does need, more or less, is to be straight and flattened, and the tin snips always end up causing some sort of twist and curvature. A number of things you can do. You can either put it in a vise and clamp it flat. That's one good way of sorting its straightness out. Whoops! Keep forgetting this vise is only anchored by sheer weight. And then clamp it the other end. And just twist it into the shape we want. Yeah. So I'll get ready to hoik that under the back of there. Get my preferred thingy. The thing that goes on the end of the screwdriver. I think we'll be on about a 6 setting backwards. I'm just going to balance it so that the neck is more or less supported. Up sort of the whole point of we're not only converting this, but I'm going to set it up with a nice low action. So there's no point doing this and then finishing up with an action that's average. We want a decent playing action. Okay, so there's a couple of things we can do. We can just hook it out that way, and we can place our shim right there. There's already one in there, but it's not giving us the height we want, or the low, the close action we want. Now this pretty much brings it up, the strings into contact with the neck, and then we'll make adjustments on the bridge to give us the action we want. But this will give us our start point. And so as I go over, I'm just going to make sure it sits where it should. Switch the screwdriver over, get our first one, just poke them in so they hold the plate, and then we'll go in properly and just make sure this thing is all nicely lined up as it goes together. One of the things I've noticed is that you can do quite a lot with positioning of your neck just by the way you position the neck before you put the screws in. So sometimes if you've got a side-to-side alignment problem, you don't really have to force it with a shim. You can just take the slack the screws off, reposition the neck to line up the strings with the edge of the thing where you want them, and then put the thing, screw the thing tight, and it will hold that new alignment very well. Okay, so this one's going to push the plate into place on that corner. It's going to align up this corner, and then we can do the others and put some force into it. And this is pretty much the only the same torque as that which I had to undo it. Now we've got the strings capo notwithstanding, we've now got the strings sitting pretty much on the deck. You can see that we've got quite a wide, quite a lot of space down here. That's because we're at the limits of what this bridge can do, but it's not bad. It's going to give us a very different play to anything else. The strings are not quite positioned at the moment because you can see here that the roller is out of position. Again, it's pretty much a matter of if we want to do it accurately, we'll divide the available space by the available space by 5, since we can't do anything with the ones on the end. Now the adjusters on this are quite stiff, so I'm going to have to, very stiff in fact, so if I'm going to raise this up at all, I'm going to have to pull it off to do it, which is a bit of a pain, because it just makes it harder. So we're touching the deck, and I want to raise it somewhat. Let's lift it out for a second. And we are on the stops, okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a mark on here with my vanishing pen. I'm going to put a mark on the back end or on each of these things, and I want to track it as I move it round, so I know what I'm doing. So I'm going to go one full circle round on each one to see where it leaves me. And I'm going to put the bridge back on, do a quick tighten up so I can check. Probably need a bit more slack than this to make it feasible. So I'll check, and if it's no good, I'll do each side another half. Wrong way. Yep, see, it moves very, very easily. Any kind of finger pressure will start pushing it around. Okay, so there we have the we have it in a different, slightly higher position. We are now clear, but it's still very low action, so we might need to make another adjustment here. Blimey, that's almost nothing. I'm looking on the wrong scale anyway. But yeah, it's sort of 0.75 of a mil. So while I'm here, just slack this right off again. Maybe a bit more on the others as well. Make it as easy as possible. Thank you. So, hoik this off, and we'll come round another one full turn on each of those. And if we can, get this back on without too much waggling about. And then we'll see where we've got. Now we're 1.3 millimetres. I think we need another half turn. Sorry, did I do two turns? Yeah, another one turn. Let's see what we get. Half followed by one. Okay, so complete turn around again. And here we go. Okay, 1.75. I'm going to go back and do half a turn. If I'm aiming for my usual action, I don't want it to be extremely higher or different from what I normally do. So I've dialed those two back half a turn and plump this down and call that quits. Okay, so while the while all these things are off their marks, let's get the division done on this thing here. We've got zero, please. Okay, we have got centre to centre, the widest. We have got ...57. Okay, so 57 divided by 5 is going to be 11.4. So each one of these needs to be positioned at 11.4. 11.4, come on back. 11.6, 57, 44. 40 way. Okay, so first one back a bit. 11.4, and this one towards the middle a bit, quite a bit. Back a bit. Back a bit. Okay, this one pretty much spot on. This one back a bit, forward a bit. That's it. Let's get these under pressure now so they don't go anywhere. We've got our divisions nicely done, and we put it under tension so it stays. All looking good so far. Tiny little difference in width up here. Might just take a look at that in a second. It's only on the base side, I think. Yeah, it's between those two strings. It's the A. Okay, so there's our positioning. It's looking good. looking good. So the next fun part is the let's get down to the nut slots and the action we're aiming for, and I'll go for my usual 0.3 of a millimeter. What I'm thinking here is that the one that's just slightly off is this one here. So what I want to do is round off wherever it's gone. I'm going to round off that slot because I want to just restart it slightly off position. So without losing too much depth, which we've got a bit to play with, my objective here will be to round this off safely. I'm going to mark it by eye at this point because I can see. I'm just aiming to go really cleanly between two strings, and in fact that one still is dropping into a slot, so I'm just going to take a little bit more away. So I'm just putting a smooth sort of concave shape into here to allow me to put a new, there you go, that's lost the original. So now I'm going to just flatten that out a tiny bit, and I want to just cut a new, or mark a new slot and cut a new starter. And I've got plenty of height to play with, which is great. Okay, so, and actually that's now sitting exactly in the right spot. So I'm going to mark it with the permanent marker for a second. Just going to sit this back on it and see what it looks like. Ooh. That's happy, right on the mark. So then I'm going to do the starter again with the slightly the triangular feather, and right on top of that black mark if I can help it. And it gives me a slot. Damn it, it's so hard to get this right. There's now a fraction off. Just widen this out again. Yeah. Difficult, man. Come on. There's the middle place. It's the marking that does it. So I'm going to try and mark either side with my pencil, and I'm going to leave the obvious place to cut in between those two marks. Okay, so let's start with the 4/6, which is my what do you call it? It's the low E one, and I'm just going to start and cut on top of where I've already gone. And the idea now is also to cut slightly backwards because I want the string to come up off the top of there. And again, I'm just going to check this, how it's looking. That's okay. I don't want to go too far with anything, and if I've got the slot in the wrong position or anything like that. So there's a long way to go on these because I've got a lot of material sticking out the top here. So I'm going to need to keep checking, and it'll be a while before I get close to the really fine measurement side of things. But I don't want it to get stuck in the bone, so I'm sort of wiggling a little bit, giving it some extra room. Okay, that's sitting nicely. I'm going to move on and start cutting the guide slots. I want to get them all in place before I invest too much time in any one. So then I know that I'm on the right track and I don't have to restart and scrap everything. So this one is going between those two lines, and I'm just going to give it a bit of a helping guiding hand there to get it started. Before I've gone too far, I want to check. Yep, that looks good. And then I want to carry on. Again, pitching it slightly backwards so it's got that run up to the front edge of the nut. There we have it. That's good too. Go to 26, which is now the D slot. That already, it looks spot on the mark, so I'm just going to start cutting that and I'll check it pretty soon. Yep, like it. Comfortable with that one. Then I'm going to move to a 17. This is for the G. Let's see if we can get this right. And again, kind of stopping sooner rather than later to be confident that we've got it. Yeah, that looks good. Keep going a bit further with it. Sits in there nicely. And then I'm going to use 13 twice for the last two strings. Let's get the blade bit. I'll just drop it into the slot that's already there. And just start going with it gently. Drop that in. That's looking nice. Oh, and I'll do the same one for the other one. It's a bit, take a bit of slack off there. Or give it a bit of slack, I should say. Just gonna see, this is slightly to the left as I'm looking at it of the mark, but it seemed to be sitting there comfortably. Yeah, that's good. So, however far we go down now, I'm going to obviously cut the slots right down to the correct playing action over the first fret, and then I'm going to drop the strings out and we can take off as much material off the top of the nut as we want. So I'm going to kind of do it the way I would normally do it, which is to work outward from, in this case it's the D outward. I'm just going to keep cutting that slot. We can make it easier by now helping it along with this thing here, which will continue to cut the slot, but it will do it faster, and it's still in the same place. But when I'm closer to home, then I can go in with the actual file, the particular file, and round it out or shape it out at the bottom, because most of this V shape that I'm cutting now we will take away, obviously, but we can start getting closer to the ideal slot. And so you can see now I switched over as I get lower, switching over to the original, the nut file. That's starting to get down roughly where I want it to be. If it catches, stop and figure out why. It could be that that the hole has got sticky for some reason. It's getting lower and lower. If you need to, just go in one direction to sort of loosen it up, keeping the angle. It is difficult, it's harder, the deeper the slot, the harder it is to use these files. But it's better to do it this way and get the right height we want over the first fret before starting to cut away the top than to cut too much away and not have left enough. So by adding a bit of width or a bit of space with the triangle file, it just eases up some of the sticking of this nut file. And you can see it's quite deep for a nut slot, deeper than we'd want normally, but we're getting very close, or closer to the playing action. Hearing some high frets poking through. The other thing is, just going to double check the action on here, make sure it hasn't This is a very flat, well actually no it's not, that's interesting, this is a slightly different radius bridge. We've got 1.5 going over there, which is correct still, so any buzzing will be probably to do with the evenness of the frets. But we are slightly, we're playing with probably a 12 inch radius on 16 inch radius, so they are different beasties. That's the thing with tunematic style bridges, they are geared for one guitar only, pretty much. The other thing in here, there's no relief in this neck as well, so I'll just do this one and then I'll just check that through. In fact, let's have a quick look now. The adjustment is done here, so it's quite convenient. Okay. It's a little bit on the flat side. I'm just going to tweak this, or crank this to the side, if it's got any movement in it at all. You never know with a second-hand guitar what's the... Blimey. Okay, I'm going to undo it. So it's fully cranked by the looks of it. So let's see what happens when we slack it off a little bit. I'm just going to gauge between last fret and first fret. A little bit of play in there, but not a lot. Take off a bit more. We can always put it back, but let's just see what it does. Big chunk of neck. It's very, very tightly done up. So slacking it off, we're doing the anti-clockwise stuff here. Alright, that's nice. It's got some... Yep, yeah, you stop that buzzing. So we got put some relief into the neck, which it needs, and then I'll just check it as we go through, just to make sure we stop somewhere reasonable. Don't want to go too far down with this, but I don't want to stop too far out either. Let's blow out the dust out of there. Just put it there. Gotta be patient when you're cutting the nut slots. It's as simple as that. There's no quick way around it. If you go too fast, you'll overcut and you'll be starting again, which on a nut like this is, it's quite a lot of hassle. As you can tell, we've put a fair amount of time already into making this nut, so the last thing I want to do is be either repairing this or trying to start from scratch with a new one. Although it'll all be learning. Okay, so I'm gonna just have my 0.3 guide, knowing that it's going to increase as we level the frets, but there's still loads of space here, so this is a lot of cutting into the nut, which is fine. It's just taking a bit longer because it has the potential for sticking like this, so it makes getting down to the ideal action somewhat difficult. I mean, the way I could do this is I could get all of them down to roughly this, back the strings off, and then kind of file down the nut until the slots are exposed. I think I'll do that. So I'm now going to go to the 36 on the A and just fire away, get where we want to go. Again, it's starting to grab a little bit now. Yeah, a bit more. Grabbing. Okay, let's cut some on the big E. Actually, what we can do is let's cut down a bit with this. For those who don't have these files, and if you can't afford them or whatever, can't get access to them, you can do the job with one of these. It's entirely possible. Just leaves you with a triangular slot, diamond shaped slot, whatever, and you have a kind of, when you get down into the slot, the string sits in a wedge effectively. You could argue that might grip the string and cause binding, or another argument might be that because there's less of the string ever touching the sides, you could argue that maybe it causes less binding, I don't know. But I've done it and it's entirely playable, so you don't have to feel that you've got to get these expensive files in order to improve your guitar's first fret action. It's not absolutely essential. So we're heading down that way. I'm just going to go across and do the top three to get them somewhere down to that level, and then come back when I've reshaped the nut. So I'm going to stop for now, give you a break, because it's very boring for you, and I'll come back when I've finished the nut, and then we'll be able to, I suppose the first thing we can do is actually twang the strings and just see what the hell it sounds like through an amp and whether it's even playable or not. That will be an interesting thing. And I told you to stop, and you did.
Far more serious than exactly where they're buried.
I'd like to ask each one of you a final.
Well, here we have it. I think you're recording, aren't you? Yeah. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the Big Steve. Modified wide six-string guitar, playing over seven-pole pickups, and sounds nice. Split coil thing, I think. Sound. So let's turn the volume down and let's hear it distorting away. So I'm going to wind it down, but just what was a surprise to me was the fact that this thing actually does play with the seven-pole pickups. Go away. Yeah, plays with the seven-pole pickups with the underneath the six strings. And to be honest, I can't really tell that much of a difference. I mean, the only strings, well, the strings that are most out of position. The E, top E, and the B. But they all play. If there's any tiny criticism of that system, it does in my mind, it feels like there is a tiny drop off of volume, or yeah, volume over on that top two strings, and that's all I can say. And it might not even be that. That might not be true, and it's not that even much different from any other guitars. So I'm just going to see if winding that side up a fraction just counters that slight difference that I'm perceiving in volume, but it's and by the way, this is some old strings and I haven't really bothered about tuning them very well. What I've still got left to do on this guitar is to level the frets and change the action a tiny bit. I want to lower it a bit more. And I'm really pleased. And so, as I say, got a couple of things to check out. Lower the action a little bit, that's all good. I'm going to just do a mild fret leveling. There isn't a huge amount of spare metal on these frets. It's not a new guitar, so I don't want to overdo that and change the way it feels. So I'm just, I mean, it plays pretty well. If I lower the action a bit more, I may not get, it may change how it plays. We're quite high. It's actually sitting up higher than I thought it was. I don't know why. I had shimmed it, and maybe the shim isn't big enough. So the other thing I can do is actually shim it a bit more, just to. We're on two and a half millimeters down there, and 2.5 here, so just over 2.5. So I might shim this again rather than mess around the bridge, because I quite like the position of the bridge where it is. So anyway, the good thing is it's a few sort of prototype tweaks away from being finished. We've got you know, the filled in top there, which, to be honest, it's just fine. It's just workaday, you know, it does the job. It needs a polish still anyway, but you could carry on sort of sanding that and repolishing it down. But it works, it covers up, and from a little distance you don't see it. This is much more about making a guitar that plays than trying to make one that you know, pretends to be out of a factory, because it isn't. So all going good, I'm very pleased. I'm going to lower the action, do a very mild fret leveling, make sure the frets are in as good a condition as they can be, and that we've got as low an action as we can get. Do a little check on the electrics, because I think there's a wire possibly touching or loose in there. And I'm going to slightly shim this neck with another piece of copper, just so that we've got the right action. Actually, you know what? No, I'll drop the bridge down, but then I'll adjust the pickups. So, anyway, that's just for now. It's a sort of demo that it plays. It's even fun to play in this condition, and that nut's nice, and the height of the strings over the first fret are pretty good too. So, yeah. A few more little tweaks and we'll be ready to send it off to Big Steve, after whom it is lovingly named. And you know, thanks Big Steve for the prompt really to do it. It's just one of those problems. It gave me a nice challenge, and I thought, well, surely there's a way of solving this without having to kind of really butcher something to make it work. And of course there is, and actually it comes down to this choosing the right kind of guitar, but also thanks to this Schaller German made adjustable bridge. That's what really makes this little project work, and quite a bit of time and effort to do it. All right, so I'm going to do these tweaks off camera and I'll see you when it's all back together shiny and we'll send it off. Thank you, bye. Okay, well, Steve, we're just back on the big Steve here, and I've lowered the action now. It's really, really nice. It's 1.5 both sides, and I'm looking at, what am I looking at? I'm looking at, looking at the position of the neck. When we finish this, I might just tilt it slightly one way. It's got a little bit more extra room on this side, but up here, it looks pretty spot on. So much wood available. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do the fret leveling. And it has got, when we've got the action down really low, it has got a couple of problems showing up. So I'm going to use my thingy, banana, whatever you want to call it, truss rod. Ooh, that's moved. Interesting. And I'm just going to tighten this thing to give it a bit of curvature. And my aim is to map the curvature in the neck to this rod, and it takes a bit of adjustment to do that. And I've just gone a bit too far there, so come back a little bit. It's difficult. I've described how this feels in other videos, but that's now hard to tell where that is actually. It's pretty on actually, spot on. So it's a sort of touchy-feely thing. It's not immediately obvious how you know whether you've got the thing balanced onto a perfect match the curve of the neck perfectly. So anyway, we've got some wear on these frets, so I just want to run this over the fretboard just to see if we can take down any of the high ones, and maybe just take out some of the heavy wear on the lower frets. The good thing about them is that they're the holes, the dimples or the dents or whatever you want to call it from wear don't quite match up on the I'm just going to try this again. They don't quite match up with where the strings are now, so in some ways it's quite good, because even if there are some dents, which there probably will be, because I don't want this to take away too much material, so I'd rather, if we had to, leave some of the dents in, and since they're not in the exactly the same track as the strings used to be, I think it'll work okay for us. So I'm looking to take down any tall frets here that need taking down. We've got one or two that are wearing down. I keep checking this this truss rod. Just I really want to make sure that it's mapping this curve perfectly well. Still, according to this, it's not quite bowed enough, which is weird. I don't know if it's moving at all. I don't think it can be. It's a pretty rigid thing, this. Okay. That should be on. And if we want to test it out and just make sure that these strings are playing okay, we'll put them back in their slots and just give them play. Roughly in tune. Good. So we don't need to spend too much time on it, it's quite close, but I will, each time I move, I'm going to check the positioning in three different places. It's quite wide, so I actually probably need to do it in four different places. I won't get across it as quickly as I'd hoped. And that is slightly over. The tiniest adjustment is so fine. Will do. So we are now going to go, I'm moving pairs of strings at a time, so that we can cover all of the frets we need to. This is going to be stressing these strings, but we have to put up with that since we're going to change them anyway. I'm just going to do a little bit in this slot. What really I'm bothered about is just making sure that we take down the higher frets that will get in the way of us playing. So, pop that in. Okay, now we'll pull that out one way, and then we'll put this down in the middle here. You check it again. Just make sure it's equidistant, whatever that word is really. Tiny bit more curvature. Okay, and move this off. Go down the middle track. Okay, get those back in, then move that one up and this one out, that one back in and up, and that one out, a bit tight, just put it out of the way. Again, we'll check the level, or the curve I should say. I'm doing this fairly quickly because it doesn't need too much. It doesn't need too much in the first place, it's not that far out, but also I need to be careful of preserving as much metal as possible on the frets. This is slightly over curved in the centre, so I'll slack it a little bit. That's good. What I will do is I'll take off the neck again on this part of it when it comes to polishing these frets, and then when I put it back on I'll just do a double check to make sure it goes on with the neck aligned perfectly. And again, that's very easy to do by just holding it in place and lining it up where you want it to be before you tighten up the screws, and you can make sure of it. Right, last two. Move them out of the way. Drop them off. And again, check the curvature so we know we've got the right one. Slightly undercurved. A bit more curve to it. And we have to make sure these little feet are on the right or the same track as each other. It's not like that. they need to be aligned before we do it, in order to get it right. So we won't be able to get rid of all the dents in the frets, unfortunately, because of the fact that we haven't got as much metal as I'd ideally like, but we'll get rid of quite a bit of it. Oh, that's no wonder that sounds crap. Get up on your little leg pedestal, you. Okay, playing no choked notes, nothing bad. Put this away. Now I'm gonna, it'll give me great pleasure to take off these old, old strings, these strings that we've sacrificed for the purpose of the various things like cutting the nut slots and getting it all set up. So time to take these off, and then we'll take care of the neck separately, take the neck off, level and polish, reshape and polish the frets, put the neck back on, make sure it's in the alignment we want, lock it in place. I'll double check the wiring while we've got the strings off to make sure we haven't got any loose wires in there causing a slight problem, and then we'll be done and this wonderful conversion will be ready to hit the road on its way to Big Steve, who I think is going to enjoy it, because this is about as customised as you can get for a big-handed player. I can also soften off the edges of the nut here while this is off. Looking at that, that came out fairly quickly. It won't come out once it's got the load back on it. I won't glue it in place because the other one isn't, the one with the earth wire attached to it isn't locked in place. So, okay, I'll take the neck off. Nice thing about having done the fret leveling with the neck, the guitar strung, is that when you put it back together again, the tension of the strings will recreate the alignment we had before. Ding. I know where the shim is, but just for certainty's sake, I'm just going to draw around it. It was pressed up against the wood anyway, but I'll just draw around it so that in the unlikely event that I let it fall out at some point, then I'll know where to put it back. Okay, and the crinkly edge on the inside. So two things to do. First of all, I'm just going to have a look under the cover here at the wiring to make sure, check to see if there's anything going on with this wire. There was a bit of intermittent crackle or something that wasn't very good. I just wanted to make sure there isn't something obvious that's loose or touching something else. Also want to be careful not to touch these rollers here, because if I do, then the positioning will move. I'm doing the wrong one. Let's bring that pickup back up. Okay. Is there something obvious that's not right here? Okay, so it's just going to get my different glasses and have a closer look. This will be extremely boring for you, I think. You won't necessarily see what I'm seeing. Okay, wires. That's okay. I'm looking to see if there's anything touching across something that it shouldn't be touching. That is a very, very tenuous connection. Wow. That is extremely wimpy. I'm going to replace that one. That's on okay. That's buckled over. Is it touching anything? That's covered, insulated nicely. Ooh, that's undone. I'm going to take the knobs off and just tighten those up. Well, interestingly on this, we've got a big pot and a small pot going on in here. Both 500k pots, but there's an odd mix of large and small. So anyway, just quickly looking at this is very, 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 very fragile. I mean, well, it's okay, I guess, but I'm look the business. I might just consider replacing a bit of it. Just to be on the safe side. I think everything else is okay. Right, anyway, I'm going to save you from watching the rest of this. Steve, just for your information, I'll just sort this out, put the electrics back in, re-profile the frets, polish them up, put the neck back in the alignment, exact alignment I want, and then put new strings on, and we shall be away. All right. So, since you're the recipient of this guitar anyway, I'm not going to go through every little bit of it just now, because it's just going to go on and on and on. So you've seen it play, you know we're heading on the home stretch, so hopefully you'll enjoy this, and see you soon. Well, here we have it finished up now, everything tweaked, everything in order. We have the 7-6 string conversion. What a nice sounding thing it is too. Play a wide six string thing, but yeah, well, we've got a really amazing action, 1.5 millimeters down here, fret leveled frets. So although they're not 100% new, they're midway through their life, but there's a good couple of years playing left in them, and I was able to get a very nice level out of it, which means combination of the action down here on the nut and the action down here, it means this thing is effortless to play, like all the guitars I set up. Still settling in the strings. But yeah. So, oh, bollocks. Occasionally that happens. It's cost me a string. And do you know what? I haven't got another set of frickin' nines. Anyway. My mistake for trying to stretch the strings in that position. So I will put something from a set of tens in there, but then if I do that, that'll be the next set of tens I've ruined. Mm. Oh well, I'll just hold off for a time being. I'll order some more. Anyway, the point being is we have a really nicely set up sixth string. And there's nothing about this that sounds like, well, there's nothing about it that makes me think it's the pickups aren't picking up well enough. This is pretty good. Notice actually, that's the only thing I notice here. Notice how it gets louder when I bend it into the path of the pickup. It's the only thing. Only up here, really. Just listening, if you had a meter on that, you'd probably hear it just get a little bit louder. Right for breaking the string. Anyway, so I think you might agree that it's not a bad outcome thanks to the shallow bridge, and be interesting to see what it would be like if we put in the seven string blades, which of course would continuously work across all the strings regardless of positioning. So that what might be a nice solution, but that would add another £100 to the cost. But I think for somebody who first and foremost wants a guitar that's going to play and that's going to fit their hands, this seems to definitely, I think this will fit the bill, and actually it isn't at all bad in terms of how the pickups work. Down must be the humbucking mode. I think up is the single coil. I can't tell. It seems to reverse between these. So your guess is as good as mine. If I could ever find the PV manual, I'll read it. So there we have it. If you're looking for a six string with an 8.4 millimeter string spacing at the nut and 11.4 down here at the bridge, this could be the thing for you. It's a conversion. I'm Sam. This is Really Loved Guitars. And this is the first one of these, and I'm hoping that Big Steve, who it's named after and who it's for, will enjoy it, because it's been fun putting it together and modifying it.